You have your Bibles with you, I'd ask you to turn to Ephesians chapter 3, and we're going to begin reading in verse 7. Ephesians chapter 3, beginning in verse 7. The Bible says, Whereof I was made a minister according to the gift of grace of God, given unto me by the effectual working of his power. Unto me, who am less than all of the saints, is the grace given that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of this mystery, which from the beginning of the world had been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God, according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of him. Wherefore I desire that ye faint not at my tribulations for you, which is your glory. For this cause I bow my knee unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we praise you and thank you. Lord God, we have another opportunity to meet this side of eternity and to look into your word. Lord, we pray this morning that you would allow us to set idleness aside, and that for a short time we might use strength to look into your word once again, Lord, and that we might understand and know how fulfilled all things are in you. Lord God, we pray that you would be with the saved that are here before us, that you might grant them a reviving where even they're at this morning, Lord, that we might be thrilled to look into your word, Lord, that we might understand and know, Lord, that you'd make us a forgiving people and that we'd love one another. Lord, we pray for the lost this morning that you might speak life unto them, because without you there is no hope. Open your word to our hearts and we'd be faithful to give you the praise for it, for it's in Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Now this morning we'll be preaching on the way to be strong. Now, one problem I've seen consistently across the board is weak Christians. And weak Christians make up weak churches. When you get to travel about, and sometimes we get to see things in a way others don't get to see, because we get outside our immediate area and we realize that the problem is not in one place and in one area, but that it's across the board. And so let me say this to start with, in order to be an internal determination that you want to be strong, you shouldn't be satisfied with being okay. You shouldn't be glad that you're just better. You know, we always think we're better than everybody else. You shouldn't be glad at a baseline, but rather you should desire to be strong. And I really believe that we live in a day, if ever there was a day, the most anemic set of believers that have ever been. They don't have the strength really to do anything. So as Paul is writing, and he's kind of at the middle of the letter to the Ephesian church, and he kind of, in the first chapter, mapped out predestination for them. In chapter 2, he explained the wonderfulness of grace. And now he is beginning to tell them, if you have those two things, you need to be strong. You don't need to be of the ordinary. You need to be above that. So he says, whereof, meaning Paul himself, whereof I was made a minister. Now, listen, every everybody has a ministry. All that minister means Church of Christ people, Campbellite people use it as the name of their preacher. But you know, a minister just means you have a ministry to administer. In other words, you have something that you can do that be used of Christ. You minister it out. And every one of us has that. Now for some it's very different, but every one of us has something to minister out. The problem is this: we waste too much time on worldly routine things. And I dare say this, most of us never even find out what our ministry is. And the reason why is because we spend so much time doing other things. And so Paul says, he's not afraid of it. He says, whereof I am made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of His power. Now I want you to see that he attributes his ability to preach to God. Now, anytime that you have that, it's always a good thing. He says, the gift that I have, the ministry that I got, was preaching. He also, in many of his letters, says that he was the apostle born out of time. And simply the apostolic gifts were given him. I don't fully understand that like I should, but I know this. He saw Christ in the flesh. And so he was able to be an apostle. But he that was his ministry. He was a Gentile ministry to bring the gospel unto us, and he did that wonderfully. Verse 9, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world had been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. Now, if you're writing your Bible, you write that one down. And the reason why is this. He makes it very clear that the gospel is a mystery.
Yeah.
People just don't get it. That's why religion started, is because they didn't get the simplicity of the gospel. You're mine, I saved you, that's the end. So people add baptism and they add the Trinity and they add the rosary beads and all this stuff that they can come up with, because the simple gospel was too simple for them. But again, remember, it's a mystery. And that's why trying to take a piece of paper and writing it out doesn't work, because it's a mystery. That's why saying, Sally, repeat this prayer after me. The reason that doesn't work and that Sally remains in her sins is this: it's a mystery. And mysteries are difficult to solve. You have to have someone to show you. And that is the very truth of this. And so Paul makes it very clear what the religious, what the Jews, what the looked into times past, this is it. Verse 10, to the intent that now unto the principalities and the powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God. Now I want you to notice two things. First of all, it says the principalities and powers of heaven made known how? Through the church. The church is very important. The older I get, sometimes I think the less I understand about it, but I know the church is integrally important, because to it was the gospel given. And so that it can be protected and be administered in the right way. And here he says again that this unbelievable wisdom was given to the church. Why? So that it could be protected, that it could be housed away, that it could be kept in the way that it should be. Verse 11, according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access by access with confidence by faith of him. Now let me ask you this, how is your boldness this morning? What's a measure of your boldness? What does it mean to be bold? Well, I'll say this. there's not very many bold preachers anymore. Because to be bold, it's not being loud, and I understand that I'm a loud man. But that doesn't necessarily mean you're bold. Being bold means you will tell the truth even when it's not what wants to be heard. You know, everybody all upset and tore up because Billy Graham died. You know what? When I saw him with a picture with the Pope. You know, that told me a whole lot about Billy. You know what? He had no business with that man. That man is an infidel. That man is in the very seat of Satan here on the earth. And a true Baptist preacher had no business sitting down to a cup of tea with the Pope. It just should not have been. But you know what? It takes some boldness to say that, doesn't it? Because what does everybody want today? Oh, let's have a big group hug. A religious group hug. You know what? It ought not to be. But it takes some boldness. It takes someone to say, you know what? I understand what y'all are saying, but that's wrong. And I'm not going to be involved in it. I'm not going to be a part of it. It's not going to be something that I will do. And so we find then that Paul says that there was a boldness that was lacking. Verse 13, wherefore I desire that you faint not at my tribulations. Now, I want you to see, Paul makes it clear that his desire was that they would not faint. Now, first of all, for him to say that that's my desire, the possibility had to exist. You know what? I have seen people truly faint. Does anybody know what really caused fainting? It's because all of a sudden your blood pressure bottoms out completely for whatever reason. Sometimes it's because you see something that shocks you. Sometimes it's just because you're really, really fatigued. And boom, you're out. That's what happens. You know, a lot of times we faint because we bottomed out.
Yeah.
We just can't do no more. And he was fearful that this church was seeing him under tribulation. He was arrested. He was already in jail. They were threatening to execute him. And instead of being concerned about himself like most of us would, what he was concerned would be the end result to the church down in Ephesus. If he got killed in prison, what were they going to do? And so his encouragement, just keep the faith. You know what? When you see bad things happening, it will be the trying test of your faith. When you see people that you love, that you consider dear friends, when you see them turn against you, when you see them giving up the faith, and man, we have at times seen people you would have never believed that would left the faith that have left, it can bring you down. And see, that was Paul's concern for the church at Ephesus. You know what? They were grounded in truth. They knew about predestination. They knew about grace. But his concern was what they were going to do when trouble came. That was his concern. And you know what? That's a very valid concern in the day in which we live, because certainly we live in a day of very, very, very difficult troubles. Verse 14, for this cause, meaning the fear that they would give up, the fear that they would be brought down, for this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, I pray for you. You know what? You think about how many times a day, you don't have to answer this for yourself, but you look about the church this morning, and how many times have you prayed for this week for each member here at New Testament individually for their situation? You know what? We need to be doing that. We got some things, you know what? Seems like one thing after another for the last 8 months here at New Testament, don't it? Well, you know what? All we can say is, blessed be the name of the Lord. We haven't had to deal with it before. You know, I told you some years ago, this is a good thing. We had the house pretty much, you know, had a good number going, had missionaries. I said, look out, Satan's on his way. And you know what? You could call me a prophet now, couldn't you? So don't be too discouraged. So what we're to do, what I'm to do as your pastor, and what you're to do as a member, he said, get on your knees and pray. Get on your knees and pray. Don't waste your time boo-hooing. You know what? Have you ever seen that accomplish anything? I haven't. Not one thing. And so what we need to do is pray. Pray for one another. Pray the Lord would be lifted up and whatever might happen, but pray. And that was his advice. That's what I'm doing for you. Verse 15, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory. So it comes from God in all the glory that encompasses who he is, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man. Now I want you to see, he says, I pray that you be strengthened. And the way that I'm going to pray that happens is by the Spirit. Now, I'll give you a couple of examples of that. First of all, if you want to be strengthened in the things of God, you better be familiar with the Holy Spirit and the Holy Ghost. Because according to this, that's what I'm praying for, right? Now, the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, see, the reason he is a strengthening force, he can make that book more than a book to you. He can make it the word of life, the bread of life. That takes the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, for that to occur. It's to make that book a living book. And then another way that he can bring strength to you is in your prayer life. You know what? I'd be very careful with prayer life where the Holy Ghost didn't meet with me.
Yeah.
Because you know what Paul, you know what the Lord Jesus warned him against? Vain repetitions.
Amen.
Remember? And so if our prayer life has been reduced to nothing but bless mama, bless daddy, help baby, help wife, then you know what? We have a real problem, and it's a problem that has to be dealt with. So this praying that he advised cannot be praying that's of a routine quality. It cannot be a prayer where you're just going through a routine and saying all that you always say, but rather a prayer mingled with the Holy Ghost. That's what we need. That's what he wanted for them. And you know that? Therein is where the strength lies. So the Word of God and a decent, good prayer life, that's where your strength is. And I'll go further even to say, if you're lacking strength this morning, you're lacking one of both. You're lacking one of both. And so then we as the Lord's people, we need to have a desire to be strong. When did it get to be okay to be routine? When did we arrive to the point that just being so-so is okay? When did we decline to the point that we no longer wanted time alone with God?
Yeah.
You know, when did that happen? We need to be strong individuals. We need to be individuals that are bent on being near unto God. We need to be strong. And you know, experience will either defeat you or it will make you strong. It's not a pleasant thing to go through hardship, but it will make you strong. It's not a pleasant thing to go through trials, but they will make you strong. Go with me to Philippians chapter 4, probably one of the most familiar verses in the Bible. It's a lot of time taken out of context, but I'm going to read it. Philippians chapter 4 and verse 13. Philippians chapter 4 and verse 13, the Bible says, I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me. Now, I want you to notice two things. First of all, you have your beanie hands that says, well, I can do all things through Christ. And you know what? That doesn't mean that you get to levitate. That doesn't mean you get to float above everybody else. That doesn't mean that you'll raise the dead. But he says, I can do all things. Now, if you'll read what he was talking about, it was very ordinary things. like being beat. It was ordinary things like being thrown in the slammer. But he says, I can do that through Christ which strengthens me. I can go there. If I have to go to the jail for preaching the word of God, I can do that through Christ. Now, I also want you to see this. He says, through Christ which strengtheneth me. So, if you don't know Christ, I mean really know Him, I can say this already, you have no strength. Because He says, through Christ, I can do that through Christ, which strength, in other words, strength comes from Christ. And if you don't know Christ, if you're not in an intimate relationship with Him, certainly you're going to be weak. So why do people fail so frequently today? Well, I really believe it's this, they don't know Christ to start with. They just don't know Him. And if you're not plugged in and you don't have a source of strength other than yourself, certainly, yes, you're going to fail. You're going to be in a horrible situation. And you can go back this week and read verses 10, 11, and 12. And he was thinking about, he was speaking of things about being hungry and being left alone. And he says, I can handle all that through Christ which strengthens me. You know what? There's a lot of things that I would have to say, hey, I don't know that I could do that. You know, we need to get to be a point of a group of people that we can just talk. And when they have a gun to your head, and they say you deny the name of Christ or die, we'd all like to say, well, I just choose to die. Well, I'll say this, and put Barry at the first of this, it'll take a strength I don't have right now. Right? Through Christ, which strengtheneth me. But you know what? I do believe this, in that day and in that time, if I needed that strength, and I'm plugged in, and I'm praying, guess what? I guess I'll have the ability through Christ to say, pull the trigger. Right? And so then we as the Lord's people, we need to understand and know what the strength of God is about. And on the flip side of that, what the weakness that this flesh contains. Go with Colossians, just a page over. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 11. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 11. Strengthened with all might, according to His glorious power. So where does the strength come from? From Christ. From His glorious power. Now that power means just what it says, like hit it as hard as you can, power. Now sometimes that word is translated authority. When He said all power is given unto me, that's authority. Here it says power just like it is, just give it with all you got. But where does that power come from? It comes from Christ. Now, we've lived way too long with men and preachers that think it comes from them. And it just simply doesn't. And you know what? If you're living in that pretense this morning, then you need to find what the real strength is about. You need to understand and know that strength, that ability comes only from Christ. And if you're getting your strength anywhere from anything else, then you're not getting it from where it should be. So it's just strengthened with all might according to His, meaning Christ's, glorious power unto all patience. Now, when we think of strength, too often that we think of is picking something up and doing something miraculous. But you know, what I have found even in physical strength, it really depends on the job you're doing. Have you ever noticed that some men are just geared one way or another? Now, I have trouble picking up some things. But I could go downstairs right now and pick up Joey and carry him just like this. You know why? Because I'm geared that way. I've carried people around my whole life.
Now, if I had to pick up a 50-pound, 100-pound pack of feed, you know what? I'd probably be a little... I could do it. I'd get it up the hill. I have. But it's weighted different. You know what I mean? It's different the way that it feels. And so every man has his own job. You see what I'm saying? You're geared a certain way, and the weight that you carry. So what you're strong in may be teaching the Word of God. What you're strong in may be preaching. What you're strong in may be just singing. What you're strong in may just be being consistent and showing up at the house of God at the right time in the right place and being faithful into that. But I want you to see, once you're strengthened, you have this glorious power. It says, unto all patience. Have you ever thought about being strengthened just to wait? Now, the only military person we have in the room is Brother Junior. But since I've been in my present job, I've learned a lot more about the military and the term hurry up and wait. You get all ready, you get all junked up to go, and then you wait. And you know what? Sometimes that's just, you know what? I'll say this, when I'm really plugged in the way I should be, I'm waiting. When's the sound going to be? It's enough. Come up here. But other times I'm not nearly as plugged in. And I'd like to see this happen, and I'd like to see that happen, and I'd like to see this before I go. No, when you're strong, you're patient. And you know what? I think we live in the day of the least patience that I've ever seen. And people don't even want to strive to have patience. So he says, to his glorious power, unto all patience and long-suffering. Now, how long is long? I'll be 50 in December. That's long, ain't it? You know what? 80's longer. Kind of relative, ain't it? Long-suffering can mean a lot of different things to a lot of different situations. But if you're strong, anticipate long suffering. Now, the thing, and it seems like it seems easy, but you know, again, it's a spiritual thing. To be long suffering, there has to be something that instigates the suffering, and then it has to last a while. As those things go down to the faithful few, people get discouraged, don't they? People want to quit. You know how long it's been? Less than 6 months. It ain't been that long. You ain't suffered yet. Right? Am I right or am I wrong? Amen or oh me? And so what we need to do is to remember what long is about. Long could be 6 months. Long could be 8 years. And you know what? Long could be 50 years. Long suffering. See, what makes the difference is during this time, are you weak or are you strong? And you know what? If you're weak, you'll be snuffed out by the devil in the middle of this thing because you are weak. It takes strong, strong Christians to be long-suffering. And we as the Lord's people, that ought to be our goal, and it ought to be our desire that we would be just like that. Unto all patience and long-suffering with joyfulness. With joyfulness. In other words, you don't got the boo-hoos. You know, but joyfully. And you know, Lord Jesus, when he was talking about fasting in his own ministry, he says, be ye not unto like the scribes and Pharisees who make long their faces. But he said, wash your face. Look happy, be glad during the times of long suffering. In the times when it's difficult, you put on a happy face and you give encouragement to others So when the suffering comes, and it's a long time involved with it, just smile and be happy. Be glad, because you know what? You're still saved. You know what? You're still going home to glory. And if you're really strong, you're still strong. And so we ought to give the Lord the great praise and the glory when these little elements come up and this little time of difficulty comes at times, and give Him great praise and glory. 2 Timothy. I've read this so many times you ought to be able to quote it. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 17. 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 17. Now just above this, Paul had written this: "For Demas hath forsaken me." Why did Demas go? "For Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world." Just above that he says, "Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil." You know what? Alexander and Demas gave up. Right? That's the only thing you can come to. That's the only conclusion you could arrive at, is that Alexander and Demas had quit. They were no longer with him. So in verse 17, Paul says this: "Notwithstanding," in other words, despite all that, disregarding that, it doesn't matter what they did, the Lord stood with me. So, did it really matter what Demas was doing? You know what? You're not going to have to answer for Demas. You're going to have to answer for you.
Right. Yeah.
You're not going to have to answer for the coppersmith. You're going to have to answer for you. So, even that he acknowledged, yeah, you know what? They kicked me when I was down. It was a bad thing. They did me much evil. But the Lord stood with me. You know what? What really matters is this, is where your strength lies, is when people begin to forsake you, and people begin to give up on you, and people begin to pull away from you, do you really, are you plugged into the Lord? "Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me." So that tells me you can always get stronger. There's not a Paul here among us. Not one person that gladly, at least at the present, maybe when push comes to shove, we will, but we gladly lay his life down for the faith. Tells me two things: you can be stronger, and you can get stronger. In other words, the need can be there, and Christ can fulfill that need. How strong are you? How much strength do you possess? How much spiritual fortitude do you have this morning? If things get better, good. If they don't, how strong are you? "Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, that by the preaching, that by me the preaching might be fully known, that all the Gentiles might hear, and I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion." Now, I personally take that to be literal. I don't think he was referring to Daniel, because he didn't say he was. And he was a very good Jewish scholar. Somewhere along the way, he'd been thrown in the lion's den. And the Bible says, God delivered me. He delivered me out of it. You know what? You may get into what looks like a pretty hopeless situation. And then all that really matters is how well are you plugged in? How strong are you? How near unto the Lord are you? Do you have the strength to get through this thing? And it all comes from the Lord. 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 10. 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 10, the Bible says this:
But the God of all grace, who hath called us into his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you. Now, I want you to notice, first of all, there's that element again that none of us really like, and that is that suffering. He says, after that you have suffered a while. You know what? A while can mean a lot of different things to a lot of different people. You ask, how long have you and your wife been married? And I say, a while. Shouldn't be 30 years. It'll be 30 years in August. Did I tell you the truth? Sure I did. That's a while. How long have you worked at the nursing home? A while. That's 6 months. I didn't lie to you. So I don't know how long that suffering is going to be, but it could be a long time. After suffering a while, a good peace, after suffering a while, and the Lord Jesus Christ, He knows exactly how long that needs to be, how long you need to be put in that situation. After you have suffered a while, will make you perfect or complete or full, establish, strengthen. Now, it should be a very natural desire in the believer's heart to want to be stronger in the faith. I don't see that a whole lot anymore necessarily, but I want to be a strong Christian. Do you? I mean, I really do. I want to have a strong testimony in the community that I live, in the place where I work. I want to be strong. But according to this, if I say that and if I truly mean it, then what's going to happen is you're going to have to suffer for a little while. You're going to have to go through some things. It's going to have to be a difficulty there if you truly want to be strong. Now, if you're just saying empty words because they sound nice and you know it says something about it in the Bible, listen, suffering won't come. But if you mean it and you really want to be strong in the Lord, suffering is a piece of that, an element that you cannot miss. Because if I understand this verse like I think I do, you can't have one without the other. Yeah. You can't have the strength without the suffering. And then it said that He would establish you, make you strong. That's where we as the Lord's people need to be. Last place in the book of the Revelation, chapter 3. The portion that's given to the church letters. He says in the first verse, and the angel of the church in Sardis write these things, saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars, I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and are dead. In other words, the church was gone. They was meeting every Sunday morning at 10, but God didn't meet with them. It was gone. There was no presence there. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die. Now, what are the things? We don't have things in a church, do we? We shouldn't have. We don't have crucifix. We don't have statues. You know what the things are? They're me, and they're you, and they're you, and they're you, and you, they're you. Strengthen the ones that remain. We need to strengthen one another. You know what? When you see me down, say, Larry, I'm not going to pry into this with you, but I just want you to know I'm praying for you. I don't know what the deal is. Don't need to know what the deal is, but I'm praying for you. Donna, I've been on my knees before Jesus for you today. Things will be well. Strengthen the things that remain, because you know what? He didn't say anything about the things that was already gone. Because you know, once they're gone, you just can't get them back.
Right.
So pray for the things that remain. Pray for the things that are present. Pray things for things that are here.
We need to pray for that. We need to pray that the Lord would be lifted up in every little thing that we try to do. And in just 2 weeks, about 2-3 weeks now, 3 weeks from this, from yesterday, is the Irish festival. Time to go down and see how Erin is doing again. You know what? To my knowledge, there has never been a Sovereign Grace Baptist Church in Houston County, ever. Not an independent Baptist, but they're the kind that goes, say this little prayer with me, and all that, that type of people like Abigail. That's all that's down there. You know what? That should make us excited. That's a wide open missionary. You know what heathens are, don't you? That's just Gentile people. Me and you as heathens. That should set a missionary's heart on fire. Whole county of heathen people never heard of the true grace of God. That's coming up. You know, that's one thing that we do that still remains. Let's get on it. Maybe we're going to have a missions conference. We need to be strengthened in that. What you need this morning, maybe you don't really have that strength I've preached about. Maybe you're not really plugged in that well. Maybe you're down to the point, and I've been there, where all you can say is strengthen the things that remain. I'm done. I'm wore out. Can you do that? Can you be able to do that? You know, the Lord will give you strength from places you don't think it will come. Since I've been pastoring here, came here as a missionary in 1999, besides when I was sick, you know how many Sundays I've had off? Zero. Because if I was gone, I was preaching somewhere else. I'm not complaining about that, but I'm just saying you do get tired. Strengthen the things that remain. How are you this morning? What's your situation?